Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is on the book of Matthew. It's a series that we're studying on the books of, the months of April, May, and June of 2016. This particular lesson is lesson 7 in that series for May 14 of 2016, entitled Lord of Jews and Gentiles. That's an interesting idea. What did Jesus do to help us realize that he is the Lord also of Gentiles? Well, that's what we're going to find out. We always encourage you to have your Bible handy to check on us to make sure that we're not misquoting Scripture. And if you have it handy, that'll be great. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Our kind and wonderful Father, as always, we thank you for your presence with us when we open your word and for the refreshing information that we get there. Help us now as we see how Jesus made all kinds of efforts to reach out beyond the borders of the land of Israel. Help us not to raise any barriers that separate us from people of other nations or cultures or tribes or races, but to lower those barriers, to get rid of them, and to reach out to all around us is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to talk about three main events in this lesson that teach us some important things. First of all, the feeding of the 5,000 Jewish men, not counting women and children. Then shortly after that, the healing of the Canaanite woman's daughter. And then three, the feeding of the 4,000 Gentile men, not counting women and children. So let's begin by reading Matthew 15:24. Can someone read that for us? Matthew 15:24.
Then Jesus replied, I have been sent only to the lost sheep of the people of Israel. I have been sent only to the lost sheep of the people of Israel.
Okay. It's clear.
Is that what he meant?
Yeah, it's clear from the reading of the Gospels that Jesus spent most of his time working with the Jewish people. All through Scripture, there are many hints that it was God's intention that they do what? That the Israelites become a witness to the whole world regarding the truth about God and his government. There are many examples of this. Isaiah 42:5-7 is another example. Can someone look at that? Isaiah 42:5-7. Isaiah 42:5-7. We'll see how fast everybody is at getting their Bibles turned.
Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and its offspring, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord, and I have called you in righteousness. I will hold you by the hand and watch over you, and I will appoint you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the nations, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the dungeon and those who dwell in darkness from the prison.
Okay, so Jesus is saying, I'm reaching out to all kinds of people, even people in prison, huh? So, back there in the Old Testament, even way back there, and there are many passages in Hosea and other places that God talks about reaching out to all kinds. One of our main passages is in Matthew 14:1-21. Someone willing to take that on? Matthew 14:1-21.
I'm reading from the Good News Bible. At that time, Herod, the ruler of Galilee, heard about Jesus. He is really John the Baptist, who has come back to life, he told his officials. That is why he has the power to perform miracles. For Herod had earlier ordered John's arrest and had had him tied up and put in prison. He had done this because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. For some time, John the Baptist had told Herod, it isn't right for you to be married to Herodias. Herod wanted to kill him, But he was afraid of the Jewish people because they considered John to be a prophet. On Herod's birthday, the daughter of Herodias danced in front of the whole group. Herod was so pleased that he promised her, "I swear that I will give you anything you ask for." At her mother's suggestion, she asked him, "Give me the here and now the head of John the Baptist on a plate."
Oh boy.
The king was sad, but because of the promise he had made in front of all of his guests, he gave orders that her wish be granted. So he had John beheaded in prison. The head was brought in on a plate and given to the girl, who took it to her mother. John's disciples came, carried away his body, and buried it. Then they went and told Jesus. When Jesus heard the news about John, he left there in a boat and went to a lonely place by himself. The people heard about it, and so they left their towns and followed him by land. Jesus got out of the boat, and when he saw the large crowd, his heart was filled with pity for them, and he healed their sick. That evening, his disciples came to him and said, "It's already very late, and this is a lonely place. Send these people away and let them go to the villages to buy food for themselves." "They don't have to leave," answered Jesus. "You yourselves give them something to eat." "All we have here are 5 loaves and 2 fish, they replied. "Then bring them here to me," Jesus said. He ordered the people to sit down on the grass. Then he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looked up to heaven, and gave thanks to God. He broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. Everyone ate and had enough. Then the disciples took up the 12 baskets full of what was left over. The number of men who ate were about 5,000, not counting the women and the children.
There you go. Wow. It's very interesting. We've noticed this in a previous lesson, that when John the Baptist was first arrested and placed in prison in Herod's palace at the Machaerus, Jesus decided, because things were getting pretty uncomfortable, I guess, he left his ministry in Judea and moved to Galilee. Now, when we're going to find out when John is killed, is beheaded, and Jesus receives a message, he's now leaving his ministry in Galilee and moves into Gentile territory. So it turns out that the ministries of Jesus and John sort of move together in that respect. So what happened? Well, when Jesus received this news, he said to his disciple, "Let's get in a boat. Let's go to a quiet place and spend a little time together thinking about this issue, about the fact that John has been beheaded." And try to think about this, you know. Here are his disciples who are thinking that Jesus is going to be the next king of Israel. And John was his forerunner. And what has happened to John now? He's been imprisoned, and now he's been beheaded. And now they're following Jesus, who's following in the footsteps of John, and where's he going to end up?
This sad turn of events doesn't seem to fit with the Old Testament prophecies about having this forerunner.
Does it? Wow. Well, unfortunately, the Sea of Galilee is not very big. You can see all the way across it very easily. So when Jesus and his disciples started out with a boat for heading across, the people could follow along the shore and get there just about as fast as Jesus could. And that's exactly what happened. So Jesus ends up ministering to them, healing their sick, etc., all day long. And the end of the day comes, and they're tired and they're hungry. And Jesus is tired and hungry. And so Jesus suggests that they feed them. And, of course, that's the story that you read to us. You know, Jesus created that food out of nothing, basically. Well, out of 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. Couldn't he have made veggie links and ruscots or prunes or fruit or bananas or something different? What?
Apples.
Apples, okay. Why did he use fish and loaves of bread?
That's basically what the people of that strata lived on.
That was their common food. That's what they're familiar with. Desire of Ages, page 366, paragraph 1 to 367, paragraph 2, and Councils on Diets of Foods, page 87, paragraphs 2 and 3. This is what was their common food. Jesus didn't want them to go home and say, guess what we ate today? Now, he wanted them to go home and think about what Jesus had taught all day long and the other things that he did. Well, there's another part of that story that we need to remember that most of us are not aware of. The tradition arose within Judaism, and this is quoting from John Pauline's book, John, the Abundant Life Bible Amplifier. The tradition arose within Judaism that the Messiah would come on a Passover, and that along with his coming, manna would begin to fall again. So when Jesus fed the 5,000 just before Passover, it should not surprise anyone that the crowd might begin to speculate whether he was the Messiah and whether he was about to do an even greater miracle, feed everyone all the time by restoring the manna. So what kind of excitement do you suppose that would produce?
Hey, I'm not going to have to work anymore.
Yeah. They were so excited. Those who were present on that occasion, wow. This was exactly the kind of Messiah they were looking for, someone who would provide their daily physical needs without their having to work for those needs. They were ready to crown Jesus as king immediately. When Jesus refused to allow that to happen, they were very disappointed. Ellen White spells that out in these words. In their enthusiasm, the people are ready at once to crown him king. They see that he makes no effort to attract attention or secure honor to himself. And this, he is essentially different from the priests and rulers. What a surprise. And they fear that he will never urge his claim to David's throne. Consulting together, they agree to take him by force and proclaim him the king of Israel. They were going to do it right there. The disciples unite with the multitude in declaring the throne of David the rightful inheritance of their master. So you can imagine, I mean, what do we know about the disciples' plans? What do they want to do?
Be prime minister.
They wanted to be a part of that new kingdom, didn't they? It is the modesty of Christ, they say, that causes him to refuse such honor. Let the people exalt their deliverer. Let the arrogant priests and rulers be forced to honor him and who comes clothed with the authority of God. They eagerly arrange to carry out their purpose, but Jesus sees what is on foot and understands, as they cannot, what would be the result of such a movement. Even now, the priests and rulers are hunting his life. They accuse him of drawing the people away from them. Violence and insurrection would follow an effort to place him on the throne, and the work of the spiritual kingdom would be hindered. Without delay, the movement must be checked. Calling his disciples, Jesus bids them take the boat and return at once to Capernaum, leaving him to dismiss the people. Try to imagine how the disciples felt when Jesus told them they had to leave and go back to Capernaum.
So maybe it wasn't a good idea to feed these people in such a manner. Maybe they'd been better off to send them, like the disciples said, send them back into the villages, and that way they wouldn't be tempted to create this problem.
Never before had a command of Christ seemed so impossible of fulfillment. The disciples had long hoped for a popular movement to place Jesus on the throne. They could not endure the thought, especially Judas, we might add. They could not endure the thought that all this enthusiasm should come to nothing. The multitudes that were assembling to keep the Passover were anxious to see the new prophet. To his followers, it seemed the golden opportunity to establish their beloved master on the throne of Israel. In the glow of this new ambition, it was hard for them to go away by themselves and leave Jesus alone upon that desolate shore. They protested against the arrangement, but Jesus now spoke with an authority he had never before assumed toward them. They knew that further opposition on their part would be useless, and in silence and complaining, I might add, they turned toward the sea. Desire of Ages 378, paragraph 1 to 3.
Wasn't the purpose of most of Jesus' miracles to to validate that he was the Messiah.
Yes.
He's fulfilling biblical prophecies that are said the Messiah will do these things, and so he's doing these things out of two reasons. One is to validate and point out that he is qualifying to be the Messiah, and then also out of the empathy and sympathy of his own heart for these hungry people.
And think, if he just allowed them to make him king, the whole nation would have been ecstatic. He could have given them manna. I mean, he would have them wrapped around his finger.
But his time had not yet come, and I think he saw that the good things that they thought would have happened weren't, because it wouldn't have brought in his spiritual kingdom. They were looking for a temporal one.
Yeah.
It was not God's will that it go that way.
What happened next in Matthew 14:22-33? Remember the story? 23, to 33. Someone have that?
Walking on the water, Jesus walked.
Okay. So after Jesus has dismissed the disciples, he dismissed the crowds, then he himself went up into a mountain to pray. Between 3 and 6 o'clock in the morning, he says, okay, it's time for me to go to my disciples. And where are the disciples at that point in time?
Middle of the lake.
Why haven't they reached Capernaum?
A storm.
Yeah. Well, there was wind, at least adverse winds, kept them from getting where they wanted to go. And what did they see coming toward them? On the water?
They thought it was a ghost.
They thought it was a ghost. It was, in fact, Jesus. And at first, the disciples were terrified. Then Peter, recognizing that it was Jesus, asked permission to come to Jesus. Jesus bade him come, and what happened?
Oh, he got a big head.
He looked back to make sure that his friends were...
His pride got a little puffed up.
And it almost got drowned, didn't it? It's interesting to notice that while we do not have the actual words of Jesus, which were no doubt in Aramaic, the Greek from Matthew says, what words did Jesus say to his disciples as he was coming to them on the water?
Take heart, it is I, have no fear.
Okay, take heart, be careful, don't be afraid. It is I. Have courage. It is I. What are those words? Well, it is I, and the Greek is ego eimi. And that's a direct translation of the Hebrew Old Testament passage or word, name, Yahweh. And whose name is that? God himself. So in that comment, Jesus is actually saying, what? I am God. You don't need to be afraid, right?
Yeah.
This story and many others that we could mention clearly show us that our God is not a God of deism. What does the God of deism do?
Sets it in motion and lets it go.
Creates a world and says, okay, now you're on your own. Okay? So in this case, what do we find Jesus doing? Our God has repeatedly demonstrated his ability to control nature from the days of the Noachian flood to these miracles of Jesus, in which he repeatedly controlled the destructive forces of nature on the Sea of Galilee. So there's no question about the fact that Jesus was capable of controlling nature. So what about that? Can we control nature? Anybody try to stop a hurricane or an earthquake?
Well, Jesus said if we had the faith of a mustard seed, we could move mountains. If you can heal somebody, that's kind of crowing, controlling adverse effects of nature.
Okay.
So, why not?
I'm asking, why not? I mean, shouldn't we be able to do that? Jesus did it.
Really, I'm not sure he told his disciples to go out and control the forces of nature, but
Yeah. Well, when the Pharisees started complaining
to
Jesus,
what's the answer? You asked the question.
I'm going to try to give an answer. When the Pharisees complained against Jesus, he quoted Isaiah 29:13. Notice this very interesting. This is a very interesting passage. In the Hebrew, it says, "These people claim to worship me, but their words are meaningless, and their hearts are somewhere else." I'm reading from the Good News Bible. "Their religion is nothing but human rules and traditions which they have simply memorized." But the New Testament, quoting from Matthew, has a little different version because it quotes from the Septuagint as opposed to from the Hebrew. "You hypocrites, how right Isaiah was when he prophesied about you. These people," says God, "honor me with their words, but their heart is really far away from me. It is no use for them to worship me because they teach human rules as though they were my laws." A little different, right? So what is Jesus trying to say to the ancient Hebrews and, of course, again, to the people in his own day? In that passage. And, of course, ultimately, you know what I'm going to ask next. What is that supposed to teach us for our day?
Well, true religion flows from the heart, not by paying attention just
external
to rules.
External rules and just yeah. following set patterns. Okay, do this, do this, do this. Okay, God, I did what you asked me to do, so now you have to save me, right?
But sometimes the true religion of the heart does have spelled out procedures.
In other words, there are things to be done.
Well, yeah, and oftentimes, in the early growth of something, for example, in the military, they have litters that they carry wounded on, and when you're training to do that, they do that by what they call by the numbers. There's somebody, the guy up in the left, he's in charge of that, and they have a command, like a four-step command, that you do that, and they call out those commands. And the reason for that is, if you aren't working together in this step-by-step, you're going to tump the guy off on the ground.
Yeah.
But you get out on the battlefield, and all of that's foreshortened. We don't have time to go through all of that, and hopefully you're skilled. So maybe just a couple quick things. So just because someone may have some things kind of prescribed or stepped out very specific doesn't necessarily mean that they're using that as that's their mode of salvation. They're just beginning, perhaps, and eventually it just flows. But
well, it can be a feedback loop, like if you're learning a skill, like hitting with a tennis racket or a golf club or something. There's certain how to stand, how to grip, how to do, you know. But ultimately, you can't be thinking about those things if you're doing the whole thing, you know. But you can use those as feedback to say, well, I'm having trouble with this or I'm trouble with that. Mm-hmm. You kind of boil it down. But it still has to internalize if you're actually going to get a good swing or something. Mm-hmm. And the same thing there. We have to, if we're going to do God's will, it has to flow from our heart. But sometimes, you know, we have these mm-hmm. feedback mechanisms that keep us online so that we can to keep the flesh in line, really.
Like a child when they're very young and you're crossing the street, you know, you go through procedures there. Mm-hmm. And when they get better and older, they don't go, it's an automatic thing, so.
Okay. Matthew 15, we go to next. What happens in Matthew 15? Someone want to read the first few verses there?
"Then some of the Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, 'Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat bread.' And he answered and said to them, 'Why do you yourselves transgress the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition?'" Want me to go on?
Yeah, go ahead.
For God said, honor your father and mother, and he who speaks evil of father and mother is to be put to death. But you say, whoever says to his father or mother, whatever I have that would help you has been given to God, he is not to honor his father or his mother. And by this you invalidate the word of God for the sake of your tradition. You hypocrites, rightly did Isaiah prophesy of you. Do you want me to read?
We already looked at those passages.
Yeah.
We need to kind of clarify that a little bit. I mean, we wash our hands today. We're supposed to wash our hands before we eat.
Yeah.
But for someone who isn't acquainted with these customs, this was a ritual. Wasn't this kind of a ritual thing that they kind of
let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah.
This story is a story about hypocrisy. Are we ever guilty of condemning others for doing things of which we ourselves are either openly or secretly guilty? Yeah. It's so easy to see the faults in others, especially when we are aware of those faults in ourselves. Since we all hate hypocrisy in others, shouldn't we be very careful about condemning those who are very much like we are? Well, after the beheading of John the Baptist and the feeding of the 5,000, what did Jesus do next? He returned to Capernaum. Of course, they got there the next morning, and who was there to greet him? All the people. And what did they want him to do?
Miracle.
Give them breakfast, right? Give them breakfast.
More bread.
And the whole story is spelled out in John 6. And what was Jesus' response? He said, it's not the external food that you need, but you need to understand the truth about my ministry, about the Messiahship. You need to eat my flesh and drink my blood. Whoa! You know, that really sort of scared them.
Scares people today when they read that.
Still scares people today. So what happened? Turns out that as a result of that, Jesus' ministry in Galilee was effectively over. He took his disciples with him, and they left Galilee and headed for the pagan territories of Tyre and Sidon. Why did they do that?
As long as the food was there and the wine was flowing, why, they were ready to be disciples. But when they were expected to have a different and a deeper kind of commitment, they weren't interested.
Well, read Matthew 15:21-28. Can someone read that for us? 21-28.
Jesus left that place and went off to the territory near the cities of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman who lived in that region came to him. Son of David, she cried out, have mercy on me, sir. My daughter has a demon and is in a terrible condition. But Jesus did not say a word to her. His disciples came to him and begged him, send her away. She is following us and making all this noise. Then Jesus replied, I have been sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. At this, the woman came and fell at his feet. Help me, sir, she said. Jesus answered, it isn't right to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. That's true, sir, she answered, but even the dogs eat the leftovers that fall from their master's table. So Jesus answered her, you are a woman of great faith. What you want will be done for you. At that very moment, her daughter was healed.
It's hard for us to read and understand the story of Jesus' reaction and interaction with this Canaanite woman. Consider these points that are included in our Adult Sabbath School Bible Study Guide for Wednesday, May 11. First, it is true that at this time the Jews referred to Gentiles as dogs, bringing the image of mangy dogs ranging the streets. But Jesus uses the more affectionate Greek term small dog or puppy dog, here conjuring up domestic dogs kept in the home and fed from the table. So immediately, if we all understand the original language, there is a a clear distinction. Second, this Canaanite woman calls Jesus the Son of God, the Son of David, I'm sorry. This shows her familiarity with Jesus' Jewishness. Like a good teacher, Jesus dialogues with her and perhaps tests her. Craig Keener writes, this is in the Gospel of Matthew, a social rhetorical commentary, page 417, perhaps he is requiring her to understand his true mission and identity, lest she treat him as one of the many wandering magicians to whom Gentiles sometimes appealed for exorcisms. What did she need to have done? What was she looking to, huh?
An exorcism. Demon driven out.
Yeah, exorcism, and that's an exorcism. Yeah, for her daughter. Yet he is surely summoning her to recognize Israel's priority in the divine plan, a recognition that for her will include an admission of her dependent status. One may compare Elisha's requirement that Naaman dip in the Jordan despite Naaman's preference for the Aramean rivers of Abana and Pharpar, ultimately leading to Naaman's acknowledgement of Israel's God and land, 2 Kings 5:17 and 18. Finally, going on in the same commentary, finally, it's likely this woman was an upper-class Greek woman, we'll raise some questions about that in a moment, who was part of a class that had routinely taken the bread belonging to the impoverished Jews residing in the vicinity of Tyre. Now, Jesus reverses the power relations, for the bread Jesus offers belongs to Israel first. This Greek must beg help from an itinerant Jew. Well, Ellen White says this, not an upper-class Greek woman. She says, behold, a Canaanitish woman came out from those borders and cried, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil, Matthew 15:22, RV. The people of this district were of the old Canaanite race. What was supposed to have happened to them?
Driven out.
They were idolaters and were despised and hated by the Jews. To this class belonged the woman who now came to Jesus. She was a heathen and was therefore excluded from the advantages which the Jews daily enjoyed. There were many Jews living among the Phoenicians, and the tidings of Christ's work had penetrated to this region. Some of the people had listened to his words and had witnessed his wonderful works. This woman had heard of the prophet who, it was reported, healed all manner of diseases. As she heard of his power, hope sprang up in her heart. Inspired by a mother's love, she determined to present her daughter's case to him. It was her resolute purpose to bring her affliction to Jesus. He must heal her child. She had sought help from the heathen gods, but had obtained no relief. And at times, she was tempted to think, what can this Jewish leader do for me? But the word had come, he heals all manner of diseases, whether those who come to him for help are rich or poor. She determined not to lose her only hope. Desire of Ages 399, paragraph 2. Remember that as a Canaanite, this woman's ancestors were supposed to have been eliminated completely by the Jews when they entered Canaan 1400 years earlier. But although she comes from a very pagan background, here was the case of a woman who had developed faith in Jesus because of what she had heard about him. What does that tell us?
She wasn't put off by his statement either. She came straight back at him, even dogs eat the crumbs.
And you remember what Paul says about the source of faith in Romans? Faith comes by
hearing,
and the hearing by the word of the Lord. So this woman had what?
Heard.
She had heard about Jesus, right? Look at verses 29 to 39 in that same chapter. Someone able to read that? Matthew 15.
I've got it here. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. Jesus went on from there and walked beside the Sea of Galilee. And he went up on the mountain and sat down there. And great crowds came to him, bringing with them the lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, and many others. And they put them at his feet, and he healed them. So that the crowd wondered when they saw the mute speaking, the crippled healthy, the lame walking, and the blind seeing, and they glorified the God of Israel.
So what's the difference between these Gentiles and the children of Israel? Okay. The Israelites, they both came.
I want you to notice that that's very important.
One came for food and the other came for...
Well, the disciples thought it was all right for Jesus. They thought it was wonderful and exciting that Jesus was willing to feed the Jewish people. But they did not expect him to feed Gentiles. I mean, these are Gentiles. Okay? How did these Gentiles... Jesus is in a lonely place. There's no food around. These people have been with him for 3 days. How did they get out there? How did they happen to know Jesus was coming there? Do you remember?
The demoniacs.
Two demoniacs from that same region. Remember, previously, Jesus had said after healing them and casting the devils out of them and into the pigs, what did he tell them to do?
Go tell your story.
Go home and tell your story. So these people, these two men, had traveled around to all those different towns in that region and said, let me tell you about this Jesus. Look what he did for us. And so when the word came out that Jesus was starting to come down to their territory, what do you think happened?
They got ready.
Everybody said, okay, we got to go see this guy. What kind of character is he? What is his secret? How does he have this kind of power, even over demons, over thousands of demons, so forth?
This lady's action in behalf of her daughter, mm-hmm. could that be considered a kind of a type of intercessory prayer?
Yes. Sure. So, do you think Jesus knew in advance when he healed the two demoniacs and then sent them back and said, go and tell what God has done for you? Do you think he had an idea what was going to happen?
You bet.
Oh, yeah.
I have sometimes referred to as those two demon-possessed or formerly demon-possessed men as the first Gentile missionaries. The first Gentile missionaries. And how many people came out to see Jesus in this remote area? 4,000 men, not including Jesus, not including women and children.
And hadn't we read previously, maybe it was it last week's lesson, where Jesus talked about it was a Capernaum that he was criticizing because Sodom and Gomorrah would have been more responsive, even Tyre and Sidon. And here, this is where he is now, is in Tyre and Sidon.
Mm-hmm. Well, by the time he gets to these places, he's actually moved away from Tyre and Sidon. He's gone up to, if you read the story, he's gone up to Caesarea Philippi, and now he's coming down on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. It's very interesting. A lot of biblical scholars believe that the two feedings of the so-called 5,000 and 4,000 were this just two different tellings of the same story. Is that true?
No.
It seems so.
How do we know?
Well, the first one was to the Jews for...
Okay, the first time he was feeding 5, Jews, 000. It was after only one day of ministering to them. And it's on the Jewish side, okay? Furthermore, when they gather up the leftover stuff, they put it in specifically Jewish, if we knew the Greek, you would see that they're specifically Jewish kinds of baskets. 7 baskets, right? When he goes over to the Gentile side, he's specifically dealing with Gentiles. He's in Gentile territory, and when they gather up the extra food, they put it in specifically in 12. I have it backwards. Yeah. They put it in 7 Gentile baskets. It's 12 Jewish baskets over there, and here it's 7 Gentile baskets. These are not very distinct types of baskets, different. So this is not the same story. What is Jesus trying to get his disciples to see as he does all of that?
Well, one thing is Gentiles are important too.
Mm-hmm. He causes his sun to shine and his rain to fall on the just and the unjust.
Mm-hmm.
No respecter of persons.
Was it easy for Jesus to convince his disciples that they should reach out to Gentiles?
Not if you look at the overview, it wasn't. It took right till just before he left to go to heaven.
Clearly. Well, even beyond that, yes. Peter with the net coming down with all the,
Way over in Acts 10 and further beyond Acts 11. Wow.
Even to 50 AD, the Jerusalem Council that it took.
Mm-hmm.
So, who are Gentiles today?
Well, that's a good question. I think most of us would qualify as Gentiles, Jews.
Wait 1 minute here.
Well, let's look at some passages. Look at Amos 9, verse 7. Can someone find that for us? Amos 9, verse 7. Now, this is from the Old Testament, the Jewish Old Testament.
Are you not as the sons of Ethiopia to me, O sons of Israel, declares the Lord? Have I not brought up Israel from the land of Egypt and the Philistines from Kaphtor and the Arameans from Kir?
What? So what is Jesus saying here? He's saying, just as I brought you out of Egyptian slavery, I brought the Philistines from Kaphtor and the Syrians or the Arameans from Kir?
The uncircumcised Philistines.
The uncircumcised. Huh? What is Jesus trying to say to us there?
Is he really saying he didn't just call the Jews? He may have tried to win all of humanity?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, even Elijah, when God finally got hold of him in the still small voice, God sent him to do some things, and one of them was to go up to Syria and anoint somebody king there,
mm-hmm.
which seems, why is he going over there instead of just staying within in Israel?
Look at Romans 4, verses 1 to 12. What does Paul say about all this reaching out to? And then someone maybe could read for us, Galatians 3:28.
Want Romans 4?
Yes, please.
4:1. What shall we say then of Abraham, the father of our race? What was his experience? If he was put right with God by the things he did, he would have something to boast about, but not in God's sight. The scripture says, Abraham believed God, and because of his faith, God accepted him as righteous. A person who works is paid wages, but they are not regarded as a gift. They are something that has been earned. But those who depend on faith, not on deeds, and who believe in the God who declares the guilty to be innocent, it is this faith that God takes into account in order to put them right with himself. This is what David meant when he spoke of the happiness of the person whom God accepts as righteous, apart from anything that person does. And you wanted it through verse 12, did you? Verse 7, happy are those whose wrongs are forgiven, whose sins are pardoned. Happy is the person whose sins the Lord will not keep account of. Does this happiness that David spoke of belong only to those who are circumcised? No, indeed, it belongs also to those who are not circumcised, not Jews.
Oh, wow.
For we have quoted the scripture, Abraham believed God, and because of his faith, God accepted him as righteous. When did this take place? Was it before or after Abraham was circumcised? It was before, not after. He was circumcised later and had circumcision, and his circumcision was a sign to show that because of his faith, God has accepted him as righteousness before he had been circumcised. And so Abraham is spiritual leader of all who believe in God and are accepted as righteous by him, even though they are not circumcised. He is also the father of those who are circumcised. That is, of those who, in addition to being circumcised, also live the same life of faith that our father Abraham lived before he was circumcised.
Wow.
So Abraham's the father of everyone.
Yeah, imagine,
all faithful.
Imagine Paul saying, okay, you think that Abraham is your leader? He's the one that, he's the quintessential father of your nation. Well, how did he get his act right with God? Was it after he was circumcised? Nope. It was before he was circumcised. I mean, you know, and just think how the Jews would respond. I try to imagine how they would respond to a thing like that. Wow. Well, Paul went on to say in Galatians 3:28 something really quite remarkable. Can someone read that for me?
So there's no difference between Jews and Gentiles, between slaves and free people, between men and women. You're all one in union with Christ Jesus. And of course, wow, there are differences between those people, but it's referring to one's relationship mm-hmm. to the Creator.
You know about the famous Jewish prayer that Paul no doubt used many times in his younger years?
I thank God that I am not a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. Or
yes.
I may have the order
exactly.
wrong.
Yeah, I'm so thankful that I'm not a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. And so what is Paul saying here? Doesn't matter. It does not matter.
I'm kind of glad of those things.
That it doesn't matter?
No, never mind.
Well, Ellen White comments like this, Desire of Ages, page 403, caste is hateful to God. He ignores everything of this character. In his sight, the souls of all men are of equal value. He, quote, hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell in all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. Without distinction of age or rank, or nationality, or religious privilege, all are invited to come unto him and live. Whosoever, quote, believeth on him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free. The rich and poor meet together, the Lord is the maker of them all. The same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Acts 17:26-27. Galatians 3:28, Proverbs 22:2, and Romans 10:11-13, quoted in Desire of Ages 403. Okay, so now let's try to come to a conclusion here. Can someone read for us Matthew 16:1-12? Matthew 16:1-12.
I've got it here. And the Pharisees and Sadducees came, and to test him, they asked him to show them a sign from heaven. He answered them, when it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be stormy today, for the sky is red and threatening. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of Jonah. So he left them and departed.
The sign of Jonah. What was the sign of Jonah?
3 days.
3 days? Jonah was 3 days in the belly of the whale, and Jesus is going to be 3 days where?
The grave.
The belly of the
whale. In the grave. Belly of the earth.
Did they understand what he was saying here, what he was alluding to?
Sometimes they didn't understand.
I'm sure they didn't understand at that point in time.
Did they understand the concept of the sign of Jonah and just didn't
well,
relate that to him?
They must have known the story of Jonah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jesus struggled very hard to disabuse his disciples and of their dependence upon the teachings of the scribes and Pharisees. repeatedly condemned the Pharisees and Sadducees as well for their failure to understand the teachings of the Old Testament, and especially to recognizing him as the Messiah. So the disciples got the message, and there was no problem thereafter, right?
Absolutely.
Well, are there widely accepted teachings from Christian groups in our day that are commonly believed by Seventh-day Adventists, but which are, in fact, false teachings?
Do you have something to suggest?
Do I need to?
What was that question again?
Are there widely accepted teachings from Christian groups in our day that are commonly believed by Seventh-day Adventists, which are in fact false teachings?
Mm-hmm. Some Seventh-day Adventists and, or should I say many Seventh-day Adventists and most of Christianity believe in an ever-burning hell, yes. Or at least as long as you deserve?
Yes.
Is that one of these?
Mm-hmm. Do any of us believe that God is up there with a big stick just waiting to see who's out of line so he can zap them? Well, are there any Pharisees or Sadducees in our day leading us into misunderstandings of the truths of Scripture? We've talked about the story of John the Baptist. Think about each of the characters in that. There was John the Baptist, the fearless prophet who was not afraid to call sin by its right name. There was the weak and vacillating Herod Antipas, who had stolen his brother's wife, the evil Herodias, who was willing to sacrifice morality and common decency in order to get her revenge against John. And finally, there was Salome, who allowed herself to be a pawn in the power game that led to the beheading of John. In considering the feeding of the 5,000 and the 4,000, it's interesting to note that in both cases, Jesus had compassion on the crowds. There are 13 other times in the Gospels, all related to Jesus and his ministry. Just to mention a few, Matthew 9, 36, 15, 32, 18, 27, and 33, 20, 34, and then others in Mark and Luke and so forth, in which the Greek word for compassion is used. These passages provide an excellent view of a God of love, caring, and approachability. What a contrast to the polytheistic gods of the Greeks and the Romans who cared little or nothing about human problems or human needs. What were the common behaviors of the Roman gods and the Greek gods? Remember some of them?
Well, they were capricious.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't be trusted to do the same thing every time.
Exactly. Anything else you can think about?
Seemed to be very susceptible to what Christians would describe as rather corrupt human inclinations.
Yes.
Kind of devious and out to get one another and jealous and
fighting and so forth, mm-hmm. And they would come down, and some of them came down and tried to steal human women. You remember? So there was all kinds of problems among these Greek gods. Think of Jesus' relationship to various people, various distinct stories. What about the woman at the well in Sychar? What kind of person was she?
A Samaritan.
And what did she do when after Jesus had talked to her?
She told her friends.
Ran home
her
and told
family.
She ran home and she told them that they better go out and see Jesus, or what did she say? Do you remember?
Would this be the Messiah? They asked
Come
a,
and
he,
see
she asked a question.
Someone
who's told
who told me everything I've ever done.
I did, yes.
You know, you wonder how I've often wondered how many of those people had any idea about her background?
I would guess most of them.
Might they have been curious? Oh, well, you mean this guy? Maybe they thought he was one of their former husbands. Who knows?
Well, in a way, maybe everybody knew. Maybe that was...
That's another possibility.
Maybe that wasn't such a...
I think it's
a surprising declaration there.
It's probably pretty fair that there were others there like her. Made them curious.
When Jesus left Capernaum and traveled to Tyre and Sidon and then later on up to Caesarea Philippi and then down on the east side of the of the Jordan River, I mean, and the Sea of Galilee. Some people have referred to that period as about 6 months as the period of his retirement. What would that mean?
A pausing, a reflecting, a preparation for getting ready for some big things to come.
What specifically happens during that time is Jesus tries to take, and we're going to see more about that in future lessons, Jesus takes his disciples away from Jewish prejudice and bigotry and tries to expose them to Gentile groups and tries to reach out to those Gentile groups and let his disciples see there are other people in the world besides Jews. And then we've already talked about the feeding of the 4,000 men, not counting women and children, in Decapolis, mostly Gentiles. And then finally, his last 6 months of his life, he spent in Perea. Where is Perea?
East side of the Jordan.
East side of the Jordan. What kind of people lived over there?
Gentiles.
Well, there were a lot of Jews too, but it was predominantly a Gentile territory. So why is Jesus over there? Why isn't he preaching in Jerusalem?
Trying to capture him and do away with him, the religious leaders.
Mm-hmm. So during those last 6 months of his ministry, every once in a while he would dart into Jewish territory, especially to Jerusalem. He healed, he raised Lazarus from the dead. He did a few other things like that, but almost immediately he would return to Gentile territory because
they're receptive over there.
Even the Jews over there were more receptive, and the Pharisees and the Sadducees did not have jurisdiction over that territory. Imagine the situation where God has to basically escape from his own people because they're trying to kill him. Well, a review of the events recorded in the book of Acts helps us to realize that despite all these efforts, God had to work several more years after the death of Jesus before he could finally convince the disciples to reach out to Gentiles. And it turns out it wasn't even the disciples who first did that. Read Acts 11, 19 to 26. See the story for yourself. Our kind and wonderful Father, help us to break down, whenever necessary, any walls that separate us from others around us so that we can freely spread to them the good news, the gospel, the truths about you and your kingdom, about the Bible, and about the marvelous God that you are. Help us not only to tell them about you, but to live the life that represents you, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.